Frank here with David Gunn of King 810. Even years ago when La Petite came out, you know, I mentioned in the review how I really thought it was the shining example of what music should be today. But for every fan out there, of course, there's the haters. And I wondered, you know, at this point in your career, you've done so much. Does the positivity or even the negativity weigh on what you do?
Sometimes my more optimistic friends are kind of try to show me the good things, that crazy things that people do that appreciate us or whatever. And sometimes my more pessimistic friends show me the bad things people say. But I don't know if this is a healthy thing to do, but I always think if you don't sweat the bad, if you don't pay attention to it or you don't acknowledge it and it means nothing, then the good really has to mean nothing too, you know? Which sounds kind of grim, I guess.
Yeah, it's very like nihilistic and, you know, a lot of metal bands. I don't really consider you just a metal band by any means. You know, but a lot of metal bands love to use fantasy as their lyrical content, where you've taken on a whole autobiographical nature in what you do. But that said, do you feel as though it gets harder to convey your story or open another chapter with every album that you do?
Nah, so much has done happen to me, I don't even... The first album was maybe like a week in my life. So I got a whole bunch of other weeks, but no, I guess you kind of try to think of more interesting ways to say it, believe it or not, because a lot of life, as just like it is with you and with me, with everyone, is redundant, you know. 8 out of 10 of the things you do today, you did yesterday, probably, but those aren't really the things you write about. But I still have so many ideas, that's why I started another project. It doesn't even, I'm not even kind of tapped. I don't even feel like I'm running out of anything. I got a hard drive, I think, with like 300 or 400 songs on it.
Wow.
So, I never run into that writer's block or whatever people say they get. Just wake up every morning and write.
Last time I saw you guys live, I thought it might have been a little weird. Like, you know, David Gunn has to go up on stage and sing these songs of pain and, you know, and these people are singing it back to you. They're repeating your lyrics. But yeah. Although they may not actually ever understand really what it is that a weird thing to you?
Yes. That is weird. That is really weird. I think I wrote about that a little bit in the book. It was, you know, everyone's always on some bullshit, like positivity affirmations and the things you say become, you know, and all this other stuff, which that's a separate conversation, but I wonder what it's like when you get up and sing these songs every day, what that does to you. That's kind of what I wrote about. Probably can't be good. It's like a checking out kind of thing, and sometimes it's funny, sometimes it's weird. Sometimes you're like, doesn't really mean that, but all right. That's the thing. I usually don't give the stupid ass vague answer everyone gives, where they're saying, you know, this song could mean anything to anyone. You know, it could be about this, that, or the other thing. It's about something pretty specific. It does have a couple entendres as far as one or two or three ways to take it, but it's not open to interpretation. It's pretty literal. It's pretty straightforward. All of them are. It's confusing. It really is confusing. But what can you really do?
Right.
You know, yeah. That's a waste of time to think about those types of things, I guess. I just made the shit. It doesn't matter what you think it is, you know. Mm-hmm. You can think whatever you want.
And, you know, I did want to talk about your time with Roadrunner did come to a close, and Suicide King wound up being an independent release. what was the story of doing it independently opposed to going to another label?
That was kind of the story in itself. Curiosity, I guess. And then it was appealing and it became interesting to do it ourselves, I guess. Hadn't done something like that before. We weren't a band. We were a band for a long time before being discovered, you know, 6 or 7 years, but we weren't a band that had 7 full-length albums out, you know. Sometimes when a label discovers a band, they're already touring and have several albums and have this type of equity built up, you know. We didn't have any of that. So the label is a good label, and we really had like a kind of, I was talking to him, we had this crazy dream scenario where we did whatever we want. If you think that that's not genuine, they produced a porno that I directed. You can't get much like more behind a vision than paying and putting on your books. Warner Brothers has on their books somewhere that there's a porno video that I directed. It's constant proof that they believed in what I was doing, and I liked it. But it's just like that chick that you like too, and you just kind of like, yeah, but I kind of gotta go that way, you know. Mm-hmm. And it ain't really no hard feelings. It was just felt like doing it independently was the right thing to do. Whatever the feeling is for the next one is what we'll do. Which is kind of why sometimes it seems like we don't really have an explanation for things. Because when you talk to people, they want you to check a box that they have, you know. Why is your record not on Roadrunner? Oh, you must have got into it with the label. The label must have fucked you. Or you must have fucked the label as far as, you know, how we act like a bunch of retards. So we're always getting into some bullshit. And like, oh yeah, Roadrunner dropped those guys and da-da-da-da. So, no, neither. No one dropped us. And they didn't fuck us and we didn't fuck them. We didn't owe each other anything. Our records were options. And it was never a thing where there was any type of conflict. People don't really understand that though. When you tell someone that, they're like, it almost just...
Mm-hmm. Well, I think one reason that that label was so behind you and was willing to back the ideas is because you had such, not just passion, but so many wild, amazing ideas in what you did. You know, like even watching you as early as Mayhem Festival, I remember the first time watching you, it wasn't just a show, it was an experience right away, you know?
Yeah.
And, you know, there's so many, no matter what you did, like you were invited into the world of David Gunn, you know? And I started thinking, I was like, I think what's maybe surprising to the world is that you come from such a hard spot in the country and, you know, have this crazy story. And you wouldn't expect somebody to come out of it with so much talent, you know? Yeah. Do you feel that places like Flint, Michigan are like a well of untapped talent, or is King 810 just like an anomaly?
I think it is, but I think it's a lot different though. I would be pretty lame if I sat here and said we're the only thing going on. In this world we are, but there's a bunch of rappers or a bunch of writers or, but in a smaller sense, when I look at all my friends, I'm the only one doing this. I got a lot of friends. So on one hand, I'm always confused as fuck because I'm nothing like my friends. They ain't doing anything like this. Sometimes I don't really know how I got here or why I cared that much. Mostly it squashes you though. I do think about that. More friends than not, more people I know than not. It just takes you. takes you over, ruins you. I was listening to Clarissa Shields. She was on the Breakfast Club, a boxer from Flint. She's the best female boxer in the world. And she said the same thing, like, you know, what's it like growing up in Flint, whatever. And she just said something to the same effect where it's not a pessimistic view, but you just don't see a lot of good things. It mattered growing up when I was a kid because there wasn't, I couldn't pull open an Instagram and see something good and positive and someone succeeding. There was none of that. You see nobody succeeding, nothing positive. You see everyone doing negative things. You couldn't see the rapper on the Instagram and be like, oh, if I rap, then I can get out, be straight. You couldn't connect those dots. You could, from you to the TV was a million light years away, and you were never gonna know anyone that even did anything. Now I can email you and we can talk and you can do an interview and all this other shit, but I would have never done that shit back in the day.
And that, you know, that kind of begs the question, you know, why didn't you leave, you know, at this point in your life, you know?
That's like something from that people from there don't, that only ask, you know? No one that lives there asks anyone that, you know what I mean? I never know how to answer it either. It's not, it doesn't even come up, like, if it's a multiple choice, that ain't even on the D or the E or the F. It ain't even down there. Like, oh, leave. I don't know why. I definitely never had that perspective where, what if I just left? That never even... The only way I would ever leave is if there was a something to... go. The only, when growing up, the only time I left town was like, we're going to go do this. We're going to go down here and do this. And the reason was easy. It was always like, we're going to go to Chicago and sell this stolen car or something. It wasn't like we were going to go to Chicago and like create a better life. So we're going to Chicago because we can get more money or something. It doesn't matter how bad things get. If that's your place, you know, like, it's like being in a battalion and you're fighting a war and you look over to your buddy and be like, why don't you just leave? And he's like, leave? What the fuck? No one's thinking that when they're laying down in the trench with the M4 and shit. No one's thinking, why don't I just leave? They're thinking, you know, this many people got to die for me to go home. So I never thought about things like that. And I don't think anyone there thinks like that either. Really. Some people might, but not me and not any of my friends, obviously.
What do you think is the biggest misconception about the band?
I don't even... What is the... Why don't you tell me what the opinion is? I don't know.
I mean, there's so many, but, you know, there's the people who don't believe that living in Flint is as bad as you make it. There's the people who, you know...
I get that. I understand that. There are people in Flint that don't believe that. I guess it's just from because everyone's full of shit. Everyone is full of shit, so people are so suspicious. And I don't blame anyone for that. Because you do have people out here making up fantasy shit, making up bullshit, you know, building groups and fake gimmicks and shit like that. But if this was a gimmick, don't you think I would have already jumped off the damn ship and tried something new? Because it... It ain't been worth it 100 times if it were a gimmick. That's a scenario where you ask, well, why didn't you leave? Kind of thing where it was a gimmick. It'd almost be like Truman Show. Like, the wall would fall down eventually. But 3 albums in 5 years and shit. Like, the wall still ain't fell down. When are you gonna, you know? I'm not that good. I'm not a trained actor. And I mean, it's not... The only way that this can happen is if it's real. So, the peanut gallery really don't... I can't think about that. I got too much other shit to do. Anyone there knows damn well what it is, even if they don't know firsthand. Mm-hmm. They already know where I grew up. That ain't no damn secret.
So, one thing I did want to ask is, a couple of years ago, I was so excited for these limited engagement shows.
Oh, yeah.
And it was like the coolest thing. I was like getting ready to like drive out to Chicago to see one.
Oh, damn.
And I wanted to know, is that ever going to come through, you know?
Yeah. Yeah, it probably will. Yeah, that was... We just got to sort some other stuff out.
Until then, Suicide King is out. It's an amazing record, like all the rest of them. Support. Cool. Watch King 810.
Thanks, Frank. Cool. Appreciate it, man.